A problem situation is meaningful to students, can be a real life situation, but can also emerge from the world of science or the world of mathematics. And of course, this is largely dependent on the skills, competences, interests, age, culture of the students that are in front of you. So please keep in mind that RME is different from real life stories. Even if, for example, with young students, it can be very important that the starting problem situation is really coming from real life. But it should be meaningful, recognizable, experienced as meaningful to the students. So, in short, to summarize, I try to, in this crash course, outline RME as a domain-specific instruction theory. I try to make clear that reality refers to what students experience as real and meaningful. And mathematics is something you do. I try to briefly express four keywords, namely mathematization, doing mathematics, making mathematics out of it. Didactical phenomenology as the art of identifying suitable problem situations or phenomena that invite mathematics. The use of models, on the one hand, didactical models, and on the other hand, this level of emerging models. And guided reinvention as the role of the teacher or the offer opportunities for students to reinvent mathematics, in the meantime, to offer enough guidance. And finally, the word of caution that I would please be critical when you see real life situations, in that they should not be artificial or puzzle students, but they do invite the mathematics that you want them to work on. And real life, and that is not the main criterion. The main criterion is meaning making, sense making. And in that sense, that students experience as
66 likes. Now,
so thank you very much for your attention. Thanks for attending the summer school. Enjoy the rest. And if there are any questions, I'm not sure if we have time for that at the moment.
So,
I'm
klaar mee. Oh, kijk, ja joh, als je zoekt op Frontal Instituut, Kees, dan moet je zien. Sta je gewoon bovenaan.
Heel goed. Dat is nou waar ik mijn hele carrière al naartoe
heb. Heb jij altijd van gedroomd, toch? Bovenaan staan op de web, op de YouTube-site.
Zoek naar Frontal Instituut.
Ja, de microfoon zet uit, het gaat allemaal goed. Allemaal goed. Ja, alles staat klaar.
Succes. Hey, hartstikke bedankt.
Dankjewel. Hè.
Also a workshop on our other channel. I'd like to repeat what I said in the beginning, for some people will not have heard that. I've updated the channel. We had a technical glitch 15 minutes before the start, which made us change the channel. The right channel is now on the website, just click the link in the program there for the workshop you would like to go to. And well, if that goes wrong, you can just search for the Freudenthal Institute channel. That will be the channel for the talk by Kees Hoogland on numeracy. And this channel will be the channel for the workshop on the smooth slope to slide is a smooth slide to slope by me. Thank you for your attention here. Thank you for your questions. And I hope to see you soon.
Aangezet, ja. Als je stopt met knipperen, doet het
test.
Dankjewel. Gaat het niet drie uur of een paar minuten over?
Kan je ook
even
zeggen.
Good day. We will start in 2 minutes. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good night, dear colleagues from all over the world. It's for me a big honor that you're locked in to this lecture slash workshop on numeracy. Before I tell you what I'm going to do in the next 40 minutes or something, I really want you to get into the right mindset first. And to do that, I will start up a PowerPoint within a few seconds. Just empty your mind, it takes 2 minutes. Just let those pictures come into your mind and let your thoughts go free. And after 2 minutes, I will say something about it and we can take that as a starting point. Normally, I do this PowerPoint presentation with a live audience. Then I ask to the audience, what kind of thoughts come into your mind if you see those pictures come by and you just let your mind move freely? And I will give you some answers I usually get, and maybe you can relate to that with your own thoughts. What I try to make clear with this PowerPoint presentation is that numeracy, quantities, etc., etc., are all over the world and are all over the world around us. You don't have to look very far to see numbers, structures, patterns, and that kind of things. And all those things belong to the domain of mathematical thinking. So, what we are wondering is, if that is important, if the whole world around us is drenched with numbers, patterns, and structures, how do we teach children to cope with all those situations? And that basically is the idea behind mathematics education, but it is also behind the idea behind numeracy. And in the lecture to come, I will try to make a bit more clear when are we calling it numeracy, for instance. If I talk to people from education and I say, is it important that you teach children to cope with all that situations in real life, as a citizen, as a professional, with digital things, with technological things? I think everyone gives the same answer. Yes, that is important. We have to prepare our children to cope with such situations. So there is no discussion about that. I never heard someone from education say, oh, I think the best idea is just to skip mathematics. Skip it at all, don't do it anymore, because that's better for children. Now, maybe some have that opinion, but it is very rare. So we agree on that it is important to do that. Then the next question is, and that's a much more interesting question, is what should be in education for young children, for secondary education, for vocational education, for adult education? What should be in education to prepare those students for that quantitative, numerate world around us? And that's interesting, because if you ask the question, what should be in education to reach that goal, you get completely different answers from different groups. And I like to make that a bit more clear to you what kind of answers you can have. And I made it a bit into an historical also development. If we look somewhere in the period 1950-1975, in Europe, but also I think in the whole world, just after World War II, I think if you ask that question, what is important for students to learn, I think everyone agreed on a very clear answer. You have to teach children addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, and do that with pen and paper in a structured way, so you can do the operations and you can do the calculations and you can do them and you can perform that in a good way. I think in those years, this was a very good and sensible idea. I think for now, I think maybe a lot of my audience is quite young, you cannot imagine that in those years there didn't exist a calculator yet. Everything that was built after World War II, factories, engines, machines, rockets to the moon, everything that was built in industry, people, engineers and other people had to do the calculations with pen and paper to get some things done. You cannot imagine that what is built with all those things all based on pen and paper calculations. Then the interesting part is that when we look to the period 1975 to 2000, you see a shift in education. And you don't see it only in mathematics education, but you see it in all topics, like physics, like geography, all kinds of topics made a shift from doing the basic skills, basic calculations, to also introducing in education some of the situations where you use the knowledge, where you solve problems with the knowledge that you have on mathematics and calculations. So you see here that you get context of everyday life entering the school. And that is also the period that Paul talked about, where realistic mathematics education was born and what blossomed into the theory that it is now. And all based on the idea that you can connect mathematics and arithmetic to the real world where you use the mathematics and the arithmetic. To give you a lovely example of the first thing, I can show you one clip. This is a very interesting movie. If you really like mathematics and you really like mathematics education, I think you must see this movie, Hidden Figures. And I will show you a short part of the trailer. And I hope that the sound is good enough to follow it a bit. Let's try.
Equilateral, isosceles, tetrahedron.
I have never seen a mind like the one your daughter has. You have to see what she becomes.
Come on! Move like that.
Catherine! We all gonna end up unemployed riding around in this pile of junk.
You're welcome to walk the 16 miles. Or sit in the back of the bus.
Kiss me up!
Hey, you have identification on?
We're just on our way to work at NASA, sir.
I had no idea they hired.
There are quite a few women working in the space program.
You know what we're doing here? We're putting a human on top of a missile shooting into space that's never been done before. I need a mathematician that can look beyond the numbers. Math that doesn't yet exist.
You have someone?
Running what I'm playing.
Catherine's the gal for that. She can handle any numbers you put in front of her.
You're a computer at NASA. They let women handle that sort of
thing.
Yes, they let women do some things at NASA, Mr. Johnson.
And it's not because we wear skirts. It's because we wear glasses.
You've been gone for 300...
The interesting thing of this movie is that this is in the late 60s, 1960s, when the rockets were built that put a man on the moon. All the calculations were done with dozens of dozens of dozens of women who did the calculations with pen and paper every day again, to keep the right launching angles and keep the right distances, etc., etc., because every day the situation changed and every day all the calculations had to be done again. So they really needed hundreds of people who did the calculations with pen and paper. The interesting thing in this clip, at the end, after the first rocket was launched, 2 years later, and we're talking about early 70s, all those women were fired because then in that same building, in the same NASA building, they put down one IBM computer. So the interesting part already then was that all the calculations in the 70s were replaced by a calculator, an IBM computer, who did all the calculations. And the interesting thing is that one of the women, also in the movie, knew that right away and said, oh, I have to change from doing calculations to programming, because that's the future. But the interesting thing is, and I come back to that, that most education worldwide are still doing the calculations we did in the 50s. And that makes me wonder what is exactly happening. So we go on. So we see a bigger shift even in this century, because if you see now in the test and in the textbooks, you have all calculations from the 50s, or you have the contextual assessment kind of things that Paul also talked about, that looks very much the same as they were in the 80s. But now, I think more and more the idea gets noticed that for good and autonomous and good mathematical behavior, good numeracy behavior, you need more than just skills and just that kind of contextual problems. And you see that the mathematics is more integrated with the cultural, social, personal, emotional. So you see that other aspects and other factors are very important if you look at, let me say, a good numerical mathematical behavior. And when you end up in that area, I go back, that's what we call normally numeracy. The acknowledgement also that mathematics is just not just a set of skills or not just a set of operations, but the numeracy is integrated in the world around us, but also integrated in our knowledge system. And this is a definition that is used quite often. It's the combination of knowledge, skills, and attitudes or dispositions with which individuals can cope adequately and autonomously with the quantitative and dimensional aspects of the world around us. And that's another vision than classical beneath the mathematics curricula. So that's why I asked you a preparation task, and I'm very grateful that I already got 20 or 30 answers for people who actually interviewed some of their friends or colleagues or family who is just working, what kind of mathematics they see in their jobs. So that's interesting too. And I will show you a bit that the related concepts, sometimes you also see other names for this kind of things. You don't only see the numeracy thing. You see, sometimes they call it mathematical literacy, you see statistical literacy, you see quantitative literacy, you see democratic mathematics, you see quantitative reasoning, you see in the Dutch gecijferdheid. And that's a very strange word if you compare it with that. You see also in other countries, in France, in German, and in Indonesia, it is Melk Mathematica. It can be very Melk Mathematica is I think from the PMRI project. We thought about if going into the PMRI, if you really do that now in the 2020s, and I see a lot of research for instance from Indonesia on mathematical literacy, I think that is really this kind of thinking. So it could be very interesting to see PMRI evolving more and incorporating things like numeracy. You see sometimes other concepts too, like ethnomathematics, financial literacy, health numeracy, maybe even computational thinking is part of this kind of movement. And if you like to choose me for one of the conceptual names, numeracy is rising in literature and in articles as the main concept to be used. Numeracy. A bit about the pronunciation. I'm not a native speaker, that's clear for you, I think. The pronunciation of numeracy, it can be, you can pronounce it in two ways. The British say the English pronunciation is numeracy. The more American pronunciation is numeracy. And you can just pick what you like, and I normally say numeracy. Numeracy, in that sense, is a kind of a new concept. But if you really look at where it is used, of course it is much older. Because this is interesting. Just guess what this is. It is about the dimensions of a smartphone. This kind of thing, it's about the size of a smartphone. And it has the same purpose as a smartphone. Because I don't think that there are many people, me neither, that can see what is actually on there, but there were experts, and they deciphered it. This is what is on this stone. this message. How old is this, you think? This is one of the first examples where humans used written tools to say something about numerate practices that they are actually doing in their society. So this is a very interesting example. It is from the Sumerians. A very interesting that it is around 2000 before Christ. So 4,000 years ago. So I'm sorry, but numeracy is not a brand new concept. People are doing it as long as we know. Okay, this is the picture until now. I show you very quickly a bit why it is a good idea to use that approach to look around and how mathematics is manifests itself in the world around us. And you can see it from the pictures. Pictures are very good communication for numeracy. You see the spreadsheets, you see the computational things, you see the money, you see the economy, you see the calculators. All those things are drenched with mathematical practice in use, the numerate practice in use. But not only the tools and that kind of things, but also the people. Our thinking and our body are so closely related to all kinds of things that has to do with numerate thinking and numerate behavior. We see things, we visualize things, we use the tools so that we can understand the better things. We deal with money, we deal with media, things with numbers, we do the shopping and the buying and selling, etc., etc. And that all has to do with numerate behavior. And you see that it also is rising and rising because of the digitalization and the technologization. More and more we are going to communicate using numbers, but also diagrams and graphs. And that is of course in the same domain. Especially in this COVID-19 area, all the newspapers and all the television news items are completely filled with diagrams, with curves, with tables, etc., etc. And I was quite amazed because I hear on the news and they say, oh, last week the increase in the decrease was getting a bit more. And I wondered how many people would really understand what it meant. And if you really look like you did with interviewing your relatives, you can also look at literature and you see that a lot of research is already also described how in specific areas of our society people use mathematical skills and numerate behavior. For instance, laboratory workers, airplane pilots, boat building. Now, you can have a look at this later and if you are interested to see more literature there. So, if you combine this together and you analyze it, you see that what people actually do is, as cognitive processes in the mathematical world, is interpretation of numbers and all kinds of things, is understanding of hidden algorithms, for instance, is evaluating, giving numbers to all kinds of things, measuring, estimating, critical thinking, knowing reference numbers. All those cognitive processes are people doing on a daily basis. Everyone, also children. The manifestations you see is, you see it everywhere. You see the product labels. Everything you buy has the product labels with all kinds of quantitative information. But you see it also in advertisements, in brochures. You see it on apps and websites. You see it really everywhere. Numbers are also used by politicians to convince you of something that's true or is not true, or sometimes to convince you of something that's not true. Intimidation with numbers happens because I showed you the thing about the numeracy that it is used many times. That if you look really look at the axis, that is the difference between 1.000% and 1.003%. So that's not really interesting. But you see it also in bodybuilding. And if you really analyze all that kind of human behavior, human mathematical behavior, human numeracy behavior, you keep wondering, why are the curriculum of mathematics education, especially for primary school and secondary school, still focused on doing calculations with pen and paper, doing algebra with pen and paper? Why are we teaching the children the things that computer can do better? And why don't we teach them those kinds of things that computers cannot do? And that could be for next generation curricula an interesting thought. Not to teach children what computers can do better, but teach children things that computers can't do. So the really mathematical thinking of individuals and peoples has an added value to the simple calculations computers can do. And this gives really an idea if it is not time to redefine basic skills. So for the next 25 years, because we are already in 2020, it is really interesting to have an agenda, really think about, shouldn't we redefine basic skills as they are taught now worldwide? And I think a very powerful thing to do that is using numeracy as a social practice as one of the starting points. And I will talk a bit more about what it means to use numeracy as a social practice. I hope, by the way, that you can actually read those texts on screen. So that I hope that's true. Probably it is. So I give you just 1 minute to read this part. Basically, it says, why don't we combine the things, the manifestations where you see numeracy, combine that with the personal dispositions, attitudes, knowledge, skills, but also personal traits, to, and that combinations make you effective to deal with all that kind of things. Theoretically, that's maybe more for a later workshop, theoretically it has connections with situated cognition from Jane Lave and Wenger, from cultural historical activity theory, for instance, from Engström, etc. Also, literacy and social practice is also studied quite something. I think it has a lot connections with ethnomathematics, like it is in Brazil and D'Ambrosio in South America. I think that it is also, it is very nice in this kind of things, if you have my age, to also use some historical roots, because it is not only because it could be more efficient to teach children that numerate behavior that they need, but it has also to do something with empowerment and emancipation and making good citizens and making people, give people the opportunity to be critical on the things that governments, etc., do. And one of the big proponents of that movement was in the 70s and in the 80s was, where is he? Paulo Freire. I think for people my age, Paulo Freire is really one of the big philosophers of empowering people all around the world, and he's very famous still in Brazil. He's already dead for 25 years, but he is still opposed in Brazil by all kinds of people. That's very interesting. If you are dead already for 25 years, that still people oppose you. So it says something about the power of his thinking. And I will show you a short video clip, because just from the historical roots, how he thought about using mathematics in everyday life.
gave a primary concern, not only to mathematicians, but to all of us educators who are somehow accountable for a certain amount of deciphering, should be this. Proposing to young students that at the same time, or even before they discover that 4 times 4 are 16, they should also discover a mathematical way of being in the world.
Descobre também que há uma forma matemática de estar no mundo. Eu dizia outro dia a uns alunos que...
The other day I was telling students that when we wake up halfway to the bathroom, we already begin to make the mathematical calculation. I mean, whenever we first look at the alarm clock, we already establish the amount of time we need to fully awaken, whether we woke up late, how long it will take to get to the kitchen and have breakfast, the time to leave in order to drive and get to the seminar by 8.
Para sair para o carro, para chegar no seminário às 8. Quer dizer, ao despertar, os nossos primeiros movimentos...
As soon as we wake up, our first moves, still in the bedroom, are mathematized moves.
Então, para mim, essa...
I'd like to say that this should be the concern, one of the concerns, to demonstrate how mathematical exercise is a natural, everyday thing.
In the handout for this presentation, of course, you can find the link, because it is also a YouTube, so you can have some more time and really listen on this. This was, of course, with a voiceover, because his original language is Brazilian and Portuguese and Spanish. So you can find the source there if you like to hear more of this. If you really want to do numeracy as a social practice, it implies that you take into account the multidimensional aspects, the cognitive and the psychological aspects, and also more the more individual context. And So we can now fill it in a bit. What we do there in the next 25 years, we look at numeracy as the whole amount of all the numerate practices we encounter, and really study that and take that as a starting point for our education. And that means that we have to have some aspects we have to sort out a bit. If you looked at those aspects of numeracy, of course you see that knowledge and skills, as we know, are of course a part of it. You have to know something about quantity and number, dimensions and shapes. There's a very useful way to distinguish all kinds of situations. Some situations are more geometrical, other situations are typical quantitative, other situations are about relations. So for me, all those PISA, PIAAC and curriculum domains, like quantity dimensions, are not mathematical knowledge for me, but are also a way to categorize situations. You can put situations you encounter in those domains. Of course, you have to think about what kinds of context you are using. The mathematics for professions can be different than the mathematics for you as a citizen, or you as a child, or you as a middle school student or a secondary education student. But it is so important that besides those knowledge and skills, you also think about the higher order skills. And the higher order skills is not something for better students. Higher order skills is a set of human skills. And of course you have differences between students, but all students should manage situations, analyze situations, reason in situations, do problem solving and critical thinking. So for me, I think that one of the basic skills should be more from this than from this. And I think that one of the most important things is that we notice for the last 25 years that the dispositions, the attitudes of students are as important, because I worked a lot in all kinds of countries around the world. And what is really terrible to see is that math anxiety is one of the factors that, one of the most important factors that students cannot do the coping with that kind of situations. Because math anxiety paralyzes them in becoming problem solvers or critical thinkers, etc., etc. And the interesting thing is, math anxiety, you maybe think, yeah, but math anxiety, is that a personal trait? No, math anxiety is the effect of education. Before students go into the school, there doesn't exist math anxiety. Math anxiety only exists, starts when you go into school and are confronted with endless calculations where the answers are right, wrong, right, wrong, right, wrong, right, wrong. And if you are a weak learner, you hear a lot of wrong, 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 wrong. So maybe even before you were 8 years old, you heard 1,000 times, 10,000 times wrong when you were trying to learn mathematics. And that cannot be a basis for being a higher order thinker or being someone who does that with self-confidence and with a cooperative and a curious way to examine the world around him, the quantitative side of the world around him. You must make students curious about the mathematical aspects of the world around us. Based on these ideas, we try to create, and this is a European project, but I think it is usable, I think, all over the world. We try to make a European numeracy framework where we really try to combine all those elements. So we combine content with the cognitive processes, with the affective aspects like attitude, self-efficacy, self-confidence, and the context and the themes you encounter in life. And that mix can make a very interesting learning environment. We borrowed it a bit from a European framework for languages. They use 6 levels to talk about it, and we thought we can do that also. So what we basically try to formulate is that on all those aspects of numeracy, take them one by one and try to describe in descriptors what kind of behavior you see in those levels. And basically, to get an idea, the levels X1, X2 are a bit the levels for people that use it in daily life situations and for personal use, and are very not very sophisticated yet in using this. The blue ones, I1 and I2, is more how a good informed citizen would do it, who reads the papers and can understand and try to understand what is in the newspaper and that kind of things. And Z1, Z2 is more the professional use and the specialized societal and work situations. So you can try to describe all those aspects of numeracy. And of course, then is the question, what is numeracy, what is mathematics? But that is a bit the point. Mathematics is a very firm concept. And people immediately think about algebra and geometry and doing a plus b squared and et cetera, so that's why numeracy as numerical literacy, as coping with the world around you, has become the name of that concept. So these are the aspects, and what we try to do is, if you look at this aspect, if you look at an individual, it can be very interesting if you have for all these aspects a kind of tests or assessments or tools to get an idea how people are functioning. But we are sure we are developing that network, and we are sure that every person has on those aspects a very spiked profile, as we call it. You have people that are good sometimes in content but are not good in self-confidence to use it. Other people have a lot of self-confidence, but not that much higher order skills. So you can really make with those aspects a spike profile to really think about more personalized learning or more really made-to-measure education to give to students. And it is also an idea because what we see a lot is that sometimes in very big colleges with thousands of students, they have one very simple assessment, and then they say, this is their mathematical level, and we have to do thousands of exercises again, etc., etc. So it is very good to think about a spike, so that you can do justice to more and more students and really fulfill their needs to grow in this in those aspects. So that's what we basically try to do, make those personal spiked profile of students, think about how you can make learning trajectories to improve your numerate behavior. And making those descriptions is very interesting job to do. And we really hope that next year we are going to try to validate all that kind of description to use the mathematical education community. To really validate and say, yes, those are good descriptions if you want to think about the numerate behavior. And of course, I said something about the spike profiles. How can you deal if you see a very low level on one of the spikes? What are you going to do? That's a big question, of course, in education. And that depends. It depends a bit on your philosophy on education. Sometimes the philosophy on education is ignore their talents, but only focus on the low scores in their profile. That's an interesting thought, and it is very understandable, but it is also terrible. Because you always focus on their weaknesses. Maybe you can also focus on their strengths and make those strengths better, and see if they can cooperate with others for the weaknesses. Depends a bit on your philosophy of education. But it can be interesting to have those kind of learning trajectories to maybe you could say, yeah, on a lot of those aspects, we really want them to have X2 or I1. And then we go more with their talents to see if you can have more specialized knowledge, like they are using now in professions. The one profession has a much more specialized mathematical knowledge than the others. And we are still making it, so especially for critical thinking, you're thinking, how can you make good descriptions of behavior that people are really using critical thinking in mathematics education, and how can you describe that you really can talk about it with students? So I'm getting to the end, so I hope that then we also have some time for questions. What does it mean? What is the implication for education if you take this approach? Without a doubt, you will see in lessons more critical dialogues with participants, with students and with students and pupils. Teaching will be talking about those connections with reality, and see how children and students work in that connection. I think that you spend much more time on interpretation and understanding instead of performing all kinds of things that are already done by computers. I think you see an increase in all kinds of what we call camouflage courses, where maybe the topic is differently, but in the topic and in the theme is a lot of mathematics. And I mean, for instance, if you say, I want to shop and to sell on eBay or marketplace, digital platforms, what kind of things I need then? If I want to be good in cooking, what kind of mathematics do I need? I want to be a good carpenter. What kind of mathematics do I need for that? So it is also good to acknowledge that in all those kinds of specialized things, there is a lot of mathematics. And I think the focus on problem solving, mathematizing is understanding what kind of mathematics is coming from the situation is very important. Last things, if you validate that, I think most tests used now worldwide to assess mathematical skills are very one-dimensional and therefore very poor. I think if you look at numerate behavior and you really want to do it, you have to incorporate all kinds of other factors. And not only factors that has to do with higher order skills, but also with psychological or sociological aspects. And so you can make a more complicated models that drive the quality of numerate behavior. So these are, for me as last slide, the challenges for the mathematics community and the mathematics education research community. I think for the next 20 years we should redefine the basic skills in more relevant cognitive processes and their manifestations. And for instance, in PISA and PIAAC, you see the first steps who try to do that. I think in the next PIAAC assessment, that will be in 2022 and 2023, you see some examples how we really tried to incorporate this in your assessment items. I think that it would be very lovely if all those research and developments around connecting mathematics to the real world used or could agree or could benefit from a more common framework to talk about it and to build a nice knowledge base. But I always think if you really want to make steps into the next century, in this century, really to see the multifacetedness and the multidimensionality of human behavior, I think we should acknowledge that multidimensionality and the multifaceted nature when we are dealing with practical mathematics in research, in teaching, in professional development, and so on. This was it for now. This was in a very short time, of course. A lot of information, I think, about numeracy. That is a rising concept in the use in all kinds of curriculum development, but also in all kinds of schools, especially around vocational education and adult education. And in this lecture, in this room, you can't see it, but I'm very glad that my good colleague Michiel Veldhuis is doing all the streaming and all the camera things, and he also wrote down some questions that came up, and I have to take a few steps there and see what is written there that we can have. I'll try to answer. Yes. I see a question about PISA and PIAAC. And if you really look at it, you see in PISA, they don't call it mathematics, they call it mathematical literacy. In PIAAC, they call it numeracy. But in the next assessment from PISA in 21 and in PIAAC in 22, there is already decided that they will have an overlap. So you see that those concepts are overlapping. And but both concepts have in common that they really want to acknowledge that mathematics is not a simple set of skills, but that mathematics should be connected with the real life where you use it. So you see in PISA and PIAAC as a kind of standards for curricula that connection of mathematics and the real world is really doing part of the conceptual and assessment framework. I see a bit about the numeracy. Is numeracy part of math? Is math part of numeracy? I don't know. I think that all those concepts are trees of the same, are branches of the same tree. I think everything I said about numeracy, I think that can be called also mathematical thinking. I think it occurs in the same regions of the brain doing the mathematics, trying to connect the mathematics with the real life, but also seeing the mathematics in real life and using mathematics to deal with real life, or using mathematics to change real life, or using mathematics to build things that then are part of real life, is also all of that is, I think, mathematical thinking. The last question is about some references to numeracy and learning trajectories. I don't have them right now, but you can see an email address. If you have questions, if you have ideas, if you really want in your country to make steps with this kind of developments, feel free, don't hesitate to contact me. It's always lovely to talk about it and see if we can connect all kinds of research and all kinds of development projects, as we have done before, especially in Indonesia, which I look back onto the project in Indonesia with a great joy and a great affection still. So feel free to contact me if you have questions on this topic. I thank you for your listening and your cooperation in the chat. And maybe I look at Michiel. Do we have, is there still a question maybe coming in? Or? Oh, okay, yeah, what are dimensional aspects of numeracy? Okay, that has to, yes, that has to, sometimes I said, some lectures ago, I said, numeracy is about the quantitative side of reality. Now people said, yeah, but in your pictures, it is not always numbers. It is not all about numbers. I said, nee, that's correct. It is not all about numbers, it is about, and you see it in the pictures, it is about numbers, structures and patterns. So it is basically about numbers and geometry. The dimensional is the two and three dimensional world. And I think that numbers and the two and three dimensional and higher dimensional world are all part of mathematical thinking. So that was why I added quantitative and dimensional aspects of numeracy, because when you connect mathematics to the real world, a lot has also to do with finding your way, navigation, robotica, all that kind of things use a lot of geometry, two-dimensional, three-dimensional geometry, to connect mathematics to real life. So I think that numeracy in the broadest sense has to do with numbers, but also with patterns and structures. And by the way, and that's maybe nice to have as a last sentence, the science that deals with numbers, structures, and patterns, that is mathematics. That's a definition of mathematics, the science who deals with numbers, patterns, and structures. So it has all to do with mathematics, but it is really a focus on connecting the mathematics to the real life, and even more important, to use that connection and to start with real life as the basis for a curriculum that you have to teach children. Thank you for your attention, and I hope to speak on other occasions live to you, or maybe we can communicate by email. Thank you very much for your attention.